Good morning, everybody. How are you? It's not raining. Well, not much. And the sun is almost shining. But have you remembered? This afternoon we had great fun, those of us who were able to, setting up the rectory garden with a million gazebos and 1,000 chairs. And there will be a million strawberries as well. Not I'm exaggerating at all. So you must come and eat them, please. Even if you can only stay a little bit, do come along. I'll probably remind you about it later as well. But the weather forecast, I'm sure some of you, like me, have been watching it like a hawk all week. And actually, it looks, I think, perfect. What were we saying? It's Goldilocks. It's not too wet and it's not too hot. But we will see. I forgot it was Goldilocks. I thought it was Cinderella. Thank you. That's excellent. Anyway, let's begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Just a quick reminder. Two things. One, very appropriate today, is that with all the strawberries, all our readings, including in the pew sheet, are about God feeding us. And we'll be talking more about that later. The other thing is, with regard to masks, do, if you are able, keep them on, unless I'm leading at the front. We will be singing, but we won't be standing. Because I feel that if you don't want to sing, if you're standing for a long time not singing, you will feel very silly. So in order for us all to feel like we are one body, which we are, then we will sit. But please do sing behind your mask, if you are able. It's incredibly hard, I know. But if you're able to just hum or something, then let's do that. We want to move slowly, but we want to move forwards. So we will try that. But of course, the choir will be doing their thing, and that's great. So today is the day we can sing legally. Okay. And it's, so in fact, yes, it gives me great pleasure to say, let us sit and sing number 445, God is here, number 445. also the prayer on page 4 of the Green Book. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Would you like to sit for our reading?
Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we were sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked towards the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.' This is the word of the Lord."
Please remain seated and we will sing our next hymn, which is number 532. All creatures of our God and King, number 532, omitting star verse.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him, because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to Jesus, "There's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, got into a boat, and started across the lake to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The lake became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they'd rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the lake and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land towards which they were going. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please do sit down.
Sing with a mask on, isn't it? but we have to sort of soldier on for now and see how we do. Now, you must have noticed that, in fact, if you look in the pew sheet, you'll notice there are actually 3 readings. All today's readings are about God feeding us. We had the feeding of the 5,000, which is probably the most famous example of God physically feeding his people in the New Testament. But I'd actually like to talk, because I think we've probably all heard lots of sermons about that, I certainly have. I'd like to talk about the Old Testament reading, which is the one about manna, which I think is a fascinating word, because I've been known to sit down very hungry for a meal. I don't know if you've done this. I'm visualising a roast dinner right now, with potatoes, all the lovely stuff. Last week we had an absolute wonderful one. When the food arrives, have you ever greeted it and said, "Oh, manna from heaven, how wonderful is this?" Well, I have. Maybe it's just me. But I think that's amazing. Operation Manna. Anybody heard of Operation Manna? During the war. Absolutely fascinating. Name of an airdrop of supplies in Holland during the war. Manna from heaven. Again, same sort of thing. And wouldn't you know it, somebody's invented a company a bit like Amazon, which delivers food or other things by drone from the sky. Guess what they've called their company? Manna. I mean, I think that's quite appropriate, really. I quite like it. And I think nowadays we use that phrase to mean, I am desperate, these are the things that I need. But the origin of this word manna, wherever you hear it, is this passage that we heard. Fascinating thing. God is looking after his people. as they literally go through the wilderness, a wilderness time in their lives. We say we're having a wilderness time and maybe look back across our lives and say that period was like the wilderness. Well, these guys were genuinely in the wilderness, a time of hardship and suffering. And we find that as they go through this time of hardship, they yearn for the stability of the past and how things were before. Does that sound familiar? I think it really often does, doesn't it? But then we find God providing for their need. And he does provide not for their want, but for their need. Because God knows them the best. So he's not always going to give them what they want, just as he doesn't always give us what we pray for, because he knows it's not the right thing. He answers the prayer, but it's not always a yes. It's that endless question. And I think after this year of change and COVID, how many of us yearn just to have things normal and proper and how they should be? I'm sure we all do. I don't know anybody who said, oh, isn't this great? We've had COVID. What a wonderful thing. No, I think most of us are pretty fed up with it now. Let's just remind ourselves about the Bible reading. So the people of Israel have just moved out of Egypt, this stupendous experience, absolutely extraordinary, when God takes them away from being slaves. And they've escaped from the control of Pharaoh, the Egyptian king equivalent. And during that, they've had this breathtaking experience of the parting of the Red Sea, which closes back over their Egyptian pursuers. Very famous story. This is a stunning experience. By the end of that, they must have gone, yes, God is definitely with us, because that could not have happened without God. So they're free and they're in the wilderness, no longer slaves. But guess what? After this short period of time comes the episode we have here. Soon as things start to get difficult, and when they get a bit hungry, what do? They forget and say, no, God isn't with us after all. And they complain. It's just that endless thing, isn't it? Even though they've escaped, they're no longer slaves, they still complain. We all do it, don't we? It doesn't matter what we do. No matter how perfect life becomes, we still complain. You know, I was complaining this week. I love Stokesley absolutely, so profoundly. However, I was complaining it was too hot this week. But, of course, everywhere it was too hot. It's just that thing we do, we complain for no reason. And these people in Egypt, they say, if only we were back in Egypt, there was loads of food. And you, Moses and Aaron, our leaders. Why am I pointing at the choir? I don't know. Sorry. Moses. Didn't mean that. Okay. You brought us out into the middle of nowhere. It's your fault. Okay. And we're going to starve to death. And they genuinely think they are. So it's kind of selective memory. They remembered the food, forgot. They were slaves. They had no freedom. Oh, dear, what a thing. So responding to that through Moses, I think God does sound a bit offended. It doesn't often sound offended in the Bible, but I think he does in this passage. But he doesn't punish them. Instead, he demonstrates again his fantastic generosity. And he responds by giving them what they need. He gives them bread from heaven, manna. But they're baffled and going, oh, what's this then? This doesn't look right. And they say to each other, manna, because the translation of manna is, what's this stuff? And so the name manna sticks, and we still say it, not realizing it means, what's this stuff? So when I see my roast dinner, perhaps I shouldn't say that. It would make more sense if I didn't. Well, we heard in the reading, manna looks like these thin little flakes of frost. Now, I'd like to explain, with my scientific head on, here comes the science bit. Manna may be the crystalline secretions of the local aphid-like insect, or may come from the stem of plant Halo xylem salicornicum. No, let's not bother doing that. You can try making human explanations as much as you want. We're never going to quite know what that was and how God fed those people. All we really can know is he fed them. If we try and go into the science of it, it's just baffling and too complicated, which annoys me because I've got a scientific background vaguely, and I always want answers. What was it? What exactly was it? No, you can't find out. We're never going to know. We just have to trust God again. Because what this text is really saying is that God, once he heard his prophets' cries, responded to their need. He responds to need. The Israelites are beginning a new life and had to learn a new way of living when really they just wanted to go back to former things. But God, as always, keeps moving them gently forward, even when they don't really want to go. And he literally gives them each day their daily bread, like the Lord's Prayer. Enough for each day only, because that's all they need. And later the manna is followed by quail. You hear that bit? Quail in the Bible, I love that. And water in abundance. And eventually, it's very obvious, in retrospect, they can look back and go, wow, God fed us and kept us all that time. But at the time, they're complaining. Then later, they go, he really did, didn't he? He really looked after us. Have we got times in our lives? I have. When I, at the time, I'm complaining, I'm shouting at God, saying, this is ridiculous. Why are you making me do this? And then later, I go, ah, that's why. Now I understand. I think quite often works like that. The people of God in this can dream and hope for great things from a God who loves and cares for them. And as we trust him to guide and provide every day, even when, or maybe especially when, we can't see far ahead, times like now in some ways, if we trust him for our needs, not our wants, then God's actions, like all the quail and the water and the rest of it, will always exceed our expectations. So here's a question. What are we hungry for now? And I don't mean food. Are we hungry for deeper things, deeper meaning, deeper purpose, more connection, more love, more healing, more wholeness, courage in the face of fear? Or maybe just family and a normal social life. What are we hungry for now? What are we hungry for as a church? Are we hungry for stability and for harmony and for a smooth path as we come out of COVID and can sing once? But we're all hungry in some way. Are we expecting some kind of manna from heaven when we pray, give us this day our daily bread, as we will later? Well, in John's Gospel, when Jesus asks specifically about manna, and it does come up in the New Testament, his reply is astounding and it goes right to the heart of our human needs. Jesus said, and this is how I'm going to finish, and it's the ultimate solution, I am the bread of life, Jesus said. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. Wow. In the Old Testament, manna tells us that if we live with our hearts open to God, despite questions, God will sustain us and care for us on the journey. In the New Testament, Jesus, the bread of life, is the triumphant, ultimate answer to all our needs, for this time and for all time. He taught us, he gave himself for us, he fed 5,000 people, he filled the hungry with good things, and he feeds us today. Thank goodness. So let's take him at his word, acknowledge our weakness in these times, and trust him as our daily bread. As it says in Psalm 34, which wasn't in the readings, but is fantastic, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. There's an anthem about that. You'll have to sing it. One of my favourites. Unfortunately, I didn't give them a heads up on that. Let's just remember that. Oh, taste and see the Lord is good. Amen. So, shall we stand and say the creed on page 7? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man.
For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Would you like to be seated for our prayer?
Danny, Pauline, Doris, and Mary. comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We place into your hands those who have died, knowing that you welcome them home into your waiting arms. Be with all who mourn, and may they know your peace, love, and strength at this difficult time. We remember before you those who have died recently, including Janet Barclay. We also pray for those we have loved and see no more. Be gentle with us in our grief. Protect us from despair, and give us grace to persevere and face the future with hope in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Peter, St. Paul, St. Martin, and all your saints, we commend ourselves to your unfailing love. In merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Would you like to stand and we'll share the peace together? We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share, in some form or other, the sign of peace. So I would invite you again to sit for the hymn, which is number 664, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds, number 664. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living Word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise.
Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
Would you like to sit down? As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Amen.
Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you.
Strengthen for service, Lord, the hands that have taken holy things. May the ears which have heard your word be deaf to clamour and dispute. May the tongues which have sung your praise be free from deceit. May the eyes which have seen the tokens of your love shine with the light of hope. And may the bodies which have been fed with your body be refreshed with the fullness of your life. Glory to you forever. Amen. And so we say together the prayer on page 30. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Now, we have a number of things. Marie is coming up, Judith I think will. But I'd also like to invite children. Would you like to just come up briefly? I don't think we've got a microphone for them, but I just want them to show you what they've been doing. And I'm hoping it's something to do with the feeding of the 5,000. Here we come. Right, I think I'll probably lend you this. This could be interesting. Right, what have you got? What's this?
I've got a basket full of...
Hold it so people can see it.
With two bread and two fish.
Two bread and two
fish? Bread.
Yeah, I was going to say, that would be a new version. And we do, we've got a little microphone. Does it work?
Let's try it.
Let's give it a go. There you go, say something into that.
I've got a basket full of... Five bread and two fish.
Excellent, brilliant. Wait a minute, let me just remind myself. I don't have enough hands. There we are. Hang on a sec. Yes, you guys, it's your turn. Right, Daisy, what have you got? Hold it up, let's see, is it the same thing? Well, why have you got five loaves and two fish then? Do you know why? I know my sermons really make an impression. Is it because Jesus fed 5,000 people with those? Oh, yes. Let's stick with those. Jolly good. Have you got the same? Lovely. Excellent. Well, I think we're not going to compare and contrast, but they're all very nice pictures. That's a very nice picture. Did you enjoy doing that? Excellent. Very good. You were very quiet. I don't think we noticed you at all. Was it fun? Thank you for coming up. That's really good.
Empty, I'll just bring more down.
And something special today, somebody's just whispered to me that it is somebody very special's birthday today. So happy birthday, Vera. Thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
I need to thank everybody for wishing me well and sending me a birthday card with all your autographs. Thank you.
Very good, excellent. Congratulations again. And don't forget, obviously, garden party 3 o'clock. And we're going to start, I think, about 2 o'clock, just to get started. So any time from 2, we'll just roll up, because the weather will be fantastic. We're going to stay seated for our final hymn, which is number 652, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Number 652. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.